Greetings to all of you in the name of Jesus, the one whose birth we celebrate this time of the year. Welcome and join in our worship this morning. I invite you to turn to the green folder, number 7, which is a song that describes the overall mission and ministry of Jesus. It's taken from the prophet Isaiah in chapter 61. It's certainly included in the angel's proclamation of the birth of Jesus. And Jesus himself used this passage of scripture when he stood up in his hometown Nazareth and read out of Isaiah 61. So this is kind of a picture of the Messiah who is to come. Darling, more time.
Season, we've been pausing to be silent for a little and think or pray for those that have brought to our minds. It's a little easier today to make it dark. Special thanks to those who, Steve and Glenn and others, who've worked to provide the light that we do have. But if you could make the sanctuary dark, please. And today's theme is hope. I invite you to think about those who might be lacking hope and maybe have experienced financial loss or loss of health. One family I thought I'd mention was some of you would know Mark and Margaret Musser. We had a box in the back for them for a little while, but Mark was some. Mike and Margaret. He was without work for several weeks, maybe months, due to a shoulder injury. I think he recently started working again, and I think there was a truck accident or something went wrong with his truck. Anyway, they've been without income for a significant amount of time. No one else comes to your mind, you can Okay, if you're near a curtain, if you don't mind closing it, and when the music is finished, feel free to open the curtains again.
Thank you.
one of you here this morning. This morning, my message isn't on the Christmas theme, but it's on Jesus. So then I guess it is on, has to do with what happened at Christmas too. The series that we are going through, the Bible, the title for this Sunday's message was Walking on Water. Quite a title, Walking on Water. But I don't want you to go home from here trying to walk on water. I grew up always enjoying water. The whole neighborhood around here used to go swimming down here in the meadow. Jim Buzzer, is he here this morning? He remembers going swimming down in the meadow, don't you? Don't you remember that? Not too much. Maybe that happened before you moved into the community. We used to dam the creek up down here in the meadow where right below the new 222, and all the neighborhood children would come, and we'd dam it up to let it be 4 or 5 feet deep. That's where I learned to enjoy water. Learned to swim there, and never learned to walk on water. First thing I came to walking on water was this summer. When we were in Israel, I walked on water, but I laid on water in the Dead Sea. I have a picture of myself and my wife laying on water with their hands up and their feet up, and I have a piece of a magazine in my hand, and I'm pretending I'm reading it. So that's the closest I came to walking on water. Well, what can we learn from this passage? Let's turn to Matthew 14, 22-26. Matthew 14, 22-26. I'd like to read it first of all.
Tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. we were in Israel is, I would like to show you a picture of what the boats look like. They discovered a boat, and they call it Peter's boat. If you go on the internet, probably they call it Peter's boat. It's part of it's there yet. The Sea of Galilee got real low one season, and they seen it real things sticking out of the water, and they rescued it, and it's become a great tourist attraction. Well, even if you see that boat, you probably wouldn't have liked to be in that out there in the middle of the Sea of Galilee. Didn't look very substantial. Verse 25, now before the watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying to him as a ghost, and they cried out for fear. But we have the instant Jesus again, but immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I, do not be afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. So Jesus said, come. And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind was boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried out, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately, instantly, Jesus stretched out his hand, called him, said to him, oh, you a little faith, why did you die? When they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Then those who were in the boat came, and they worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. When they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret. When the men of that place recognized him, he sent out all surrounding region, he brought to him all who were sick, and they begged him that they might only touch the hem of his garment, and as many as touched it, became perfectly well. What are some things that we can learn from this passage? I picked some things out of them, and you can think of many more too. The first thing I picked out was that we have God of the impossible. We have God of the impossible. What is impossible with men? The Bible says it's possible with God. Matthew 19:26. With God, all things are possible. God created the elements, and he controls them, and he can rise above them. I believe Jesus was revealing to his disciples and the crowds that he was in control of all things. There's a previous account of Jesus walking on the water, Matthew 8:23-27. And you might recall that, where Jesus was in the boat this time, and the disciples were in the middle of the Sea of Galilee, and they thought they were going to drown. And then they called on Jesus, woke up, and he said, peace be still. And the waves died down, the sea became calm. That time the disciples said, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. It's interesting what happened right after that. And when they got to the shore after that, it was where these two demon-possessed men were. And they were filled with legions of demons that Jesus cast out, and they ran down the mountain into the sea. At that time, I think Jesus was revealing to his disciples that he is the God, or he has power over the elements, power over nature, and he has power over the spirit world. He is in control of all things. Now in this account, in Matthew 14:22-33, we again have him feeding the 5,000, showing that he can make food out of nothing, as you and he puts his disciples in the boat, and then he gets or places them in this situation again. And they're out in the middle of the sea, and he calms Jesus. You don't expect enough of impossibilities out of Jesus, the one who is in control of all things. Another thing I picked on is what we're having here is God just made the problems. God has many problems. I remember Carl saying something last Sunday that really I remember. He said to the new pastors, he said, "I don't want to infer, you know, you're talking about God's yoke being easy. His yoke is easy." And he said to them, he said, "I don't want to infer for 1 minute," maybe he didn't say it quite like that, "that ministry is always easy." He said, "In fact, sometimes it's very hard." He said, "In fact, in my life, I had some of my hardest times in the ministry." Well, the disciples were here. They were having a hard time too. They were experienced seamen, but things were out of control. And they probably thought they were about ready to drown in this situation too. They didn't know how to handle it. And Jesus was coming there close, but they didn't recognize him for Jesus. They thought it was a spirit, an evil spirit out there on the water. You know, I think that's a lot how many people are today. The sea is rising. They're in all kinds of problems. And Jesus, the instant Jesus is right there, and they don't recognize him. When Jesus finally spoke, they did recognize that it was Jesus, but I don't think they recognized that he could solve their problems. They should have known that he could help them solve their problems. If they knew their Bible, their Old Testament, Psalm 65:7 said, this is what it says about Jesus and about God. "You answer us with awesome deeds of righteousness, O God our Savior. The hope of all the ends of the earth, of the farthest seas, who formed the mountains by your arm, having armed yourself with strength, who stills the roaring of the seas and the roaring of their waves and the turmoil of the nations." And there's another verse in the Old Testament that they probably would have read. "O Lord God Almighty, who is like you? You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you. You rule over the surging sea. When its waves mount up, you still there." And then he should have recalled the previous time when they were out there on the sea. But they failed to see Jesus as their solution to their problems until he actually solved their problems. And then they realized that we can do all things. We can do the impossible. And Peter learned that he not only had to have his eyes on Jesus, but he had to keep his eyes on Jesus if he's going to stay up above the roaring sea and above his problems. He needed only not to look to Jesus, but he needed to keep his eyes on Jesus. I remember that story I read years ago by Charles Spurgeon, and I'm going to read it. Anybody know who Charles Spurgeon was? A great British preacher. You know how he came to the Lord? Well, here's how Charles Spurgeon, great British preacher, came to the Lord. He said, "As a lad, I had been for about 5 years in the most fearful distress of mind. If any human being had more of the terror of God's law, I can indeed pity and sympathize with him. I thought the sun was blotted out of my sky, that I had so sinned against God that there was no hope for me. I prayed, the Lord knows how I prayed, but I never had a glimpse searched the word of God. The promises were more alarming than and threatening. I read about the privileges of the people of God, but was fully persuaded that they were not for me. The secret of my distress was this. I did not know the gospel. I was in a Christian land. I had Christian parents. But I did not understand the freeness and the simplicity of the gospel. I attended all the places of worship in the town where I lived. But I honestly did believe I did not hear the gospel fully preached. I do not blame the man, however. One man preached about the divine sovereignty. I could hear him with pleasure. And what was that to a poor sinner who wished to know that he should, what he should do to be saved? I knew it was said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. But I did not know what it was to believe in Christ. I sometimes think I might have been in darkness and despair now, had it not been for the goodness of God in sending a snowstorm one Sunday morning when I was going to a place of worship. When I could go no farther, I turned down a street and came to a little primitive Methodist church. In that chapel, there might have been a dozen or 15 people. The minister did not come that morning. He was snowed in, I suppose. A poor man, a shoemaker, tailor, or something of that sort, went up into the pulpit to preach. This poor man was obliged to stick to his text, for the simple reason that he had nothing else to say. The text was, look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. He did not even pronounce the words rightly, but that did not matter. There was, I thought, a glimpse of hope for me. In the text, he began this, oh, dear friends, this is a very simple text, indeed. It says, look, now that does not take a deal of effort. It ain't lifting your foot or your finger, it's just, look. Well, a man need not go to college to learn to look. You may be the biggest fool, and yet you can look. A man need not be worth $1,000 a year to look. And anyone can look. A child can look. But this is what the text says. And he says, look unto me. Ah, said he. Many of you are looking to yourselves. No use looking there. You never find comfort in yourselves. Some look to God the Father. No, look to him by and by. Jesus Christ says, look to me. Look to me. Some of you say, I must wait the Spirit's working. You have no business with that just now. Look to Jesus. The text says, runs, look unto me. And the good man followed up his text this way. He said, look unto me. I am sweating great drops of blood. Look unto me. I am hanging on the cross. Look, I am dead and buried. Look unto me. I rise again. Look unto me. I ascend. I am sitting on the Father's right hand. Oh, look to me. Look to me. When he had got about this length and managed to spin out 10 minutes or so, he was at the length of his tether. Then he looked at me under the gallery, and I dare say with so few present, he knew me to be a stranger. And I dare say with so few present, he knew all. Oh, and then he said, young man, you look very miserable. Well, I did, but I had not been accustomed to having remarks made of my personal appearance from the pulpit before. However, it was a good blow struck. He continued, and you will always be miserable. Miserable in life, miserable in death, if you do not obey my text. Look, but if you obey now, this moment, you will be saved. Then he shouted, young man, look, to Jesus. He said, and now, and he made me started my seed. But I did look to Jesus Christ. There and then the cloud was gone. The darkness had rolled away, and the moment I saw the sun, I could have risen that moment and sung with the most enthusiastic of them of the precious blood of Christ and the simple faith which looks alone to Him. Oh, that somebody had told me before, and I am telling you now. Look to Jesus, trust Him, and you will be saved. Well, Peter realized that he needed to look to Jesus to be saved, and he needed to continue to look to Jesus to be saved and to rise above the problems. We're going to sing, maybe some of you are going through difficult times right now. We're going to sing, Who Can Move the Mountains? Okay, darkness is going to leave us. Bigger than any mountain.
I think that we know it well enough, I'm afraid to try to put it on the other. Bigger than all my problems, bigger than all my fears, bigger than any mountain that I can or cannot see. Bigger than all my questions, bigger than anything. God is bigger than any mountain that I cannot see. That's the chorus part, and we'll sing that twice.
Jesus and His Word. And I guess the older you get, the more you realize that life continues to change faster and faster. We have nothing in this life that is stable other than Jesus and His Word. Malachi 3:6, Jesus, the Lord says, "For I am the Lord, I do not change." So we need to look to the changeless one, the one who does the impossible. And then verse 20, Matthew 24:35 says, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away." We can. It's a, Jesus and His Word are a solid rock for us to build our lives on and to look to. In closing, I'd like to read Psalms 107:23-32. This talks about seamen being in trouble and then crying out to God, and God answers this, and then they worship Him. And that was another point I wanted to emphasize, that in this instance, they worship Jesus. The other time they said, "What kind of man is this?" This time, second time around, they said, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Psalms 107, verses 23 to 32. See, "Those who go down to the sea in ships, who do business on great waters, they see the works of the Lord and His wonders in the deep. For He commands and raises a stormy wind, which sets up the waves of the sea. They mount up to the heavens, they go down again to the depths. Their soul melts because of trouble." I used to go deep sea fishing with Paul Seymour. And I know you did too, didn't you? Did you used to go fishing with Paul Seymour? I can remember one time. It was pretty rough out there. And it was really going. And a lot of the people on the boat were sick, but fortunately I didn't get sick. Verse 27, "They reel to and fro, and they stagger like a drunken man, and are at their wits' end. Then they cry out to the Lord in their trouble, and He brings them out of their distress." That's what God wants us to do. And then verse 29, it says, "He calms the storm, so that its waves are still. Then they are glad because they are quiet," that the waves are quiet. "So He guides them to their desired haven." You know, God wants to meet our needs, but then we need to remember to give Him the credit and the praise. What do they do then? "Oh, that men would give you thanks to the Lord for His goodness and for His wonderful works to the children of men. Let them exalt Him also in the assembly of the people and praise Him in the company of the elders." Shall we have a closing song at this time?
As I thought about our morning together in Sunday school and sharing and singing and the message and worship and the season of the year and all of that, I've chosen as a conclusion of our morning together and kind of taking something along with us, turn to number 19 in the green book called The Message. Based on the angelic proclamation of glory to God in the highest and on our peace to all mankind on whom His favor rests. Glory to God in the highest. This is a song, a message I think that's needed in our world today of much turmoil. This message needs to be heard loud and clear, and perhaps it can be something we can take with us this week and share in our life experience. Just a note, for those of you who may not be as familiar with this song, in the chorus, the men will take the high notes, the soprano notes in the duet, and the women take the lower notes, the alto notes, and the accompanying words. So, everyone is invited to join in.
So if you could remember the Easley family. And just a reminder that this afternoon, you were invited. It's not snowing, but raining. maybe we think of for Christmas caroling, but we will meet at 3 o'clock at Landis Hymns at the Harvest View lobby where we usually sing at Landis Hymns. And then following this singing there, we will go and sing for Esther and Veronica and Mildred and George Weber at Fairmount. And then we have a couple places that we will follow right after with in the community here at Adamstown and then come back here for a meal together. So we are not having two separate starting times as we have sometimes in the past. We're a little bit later at Landis Hymns and then we're going right from Landis Hymns to Fairmount and right from Fairmount back to this area. So I invite you to come out and join the singing.
Share a testimony of experience where you know God is asking you to get out of the boat or do something risky for the Lord. Or do something that you didn't feel comfortable and God bless you for it.
Many of you are familiar with Joy in China. We asked prayer a few weeks ago for her about cancer. We went to see her when we were there. She'd just gotten another treatment. She looked really good, but the honey sent out an email yesterday that she's really weak again. So pray for her.
You can pray for my mom. She's going for back surgery tomorrow. That would relieve her back pain. That she'd be healthy.
This is an old story, but maybe it would be an encouragement to somebody. Years ago, when I was scheduled to go to Somalia, a few months before I was scheduled to leave, Merlin Rowe was killed. And I remember Paul and Crapo from Eastern Mennonite Mission saying to me, "Lena, do you still want to go?" I'm glad I went. It was 4 wonderful years. My mom used to say, "If you're sure you're right, then go ahead."
I'd like to say daughter's home. She had a little surgery, I guess most of you know about, and she's doing quite well, I'd say, so thanks for praying and for all you've done.
Glenn, your message hasn't fallen on deaf ears. There's some stories in my mind swirling, so too many to mention, but I'm sure we all have those moments where we were stretched and just, there's too many details, so I won't go into it now, but thank you for the message. It's very, very hitting home. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
This is Suzanne. So God kind of pushed me out of the boat about 20 years ago when I became the medical power of attorney for two elderly ladies who were in the congregation that I was attending. And through that experience, I was with them for about 10 years, it really enriched my life.
China team is back with us again and gave them a safe trip and a good time over there. Pray for Joy, Esther's teacher friend. We pray that you would work in her life. The doctor's wisdom in treating your cancer. We pray to give her strength back. And we pray that you give her health back too. And, that it's not against you, but all things are possible with you. Father, we pray for Margaret. We pray for complete healing. We pray that the surgery would go well tomorrow. She would be relieved of her pain and be able to get around well again. Pray for Lydia. She's planning a time. She could say getting out of the boat and doing something for you. We pray that you would bless the fundraiser that the going to have this over the mealtime. We pray that you would provide for her needs financially. We pray that you bless the food that is provided and our fellowship. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. For a benediction, I'd like to read two scriptures from Hebrews. Hebrews 13, 20, and 21. You know, it's fortunate that I'm not running out of time this morning. The clock, I thought, man, my sermon is shit this morning. Hebrews 13. Guess somebody just didn't think that was funny, huh? Hebrews 13, 20 and 21. Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead. No, I didn't want to read that one first. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and run with endurance the race that is set before us. Everybody know what comes next? Right, look, looking unto, we're supposed to run the race, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And then Hebrews 13, 20 and 21. Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do his will, working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Look to Jesus for this lesson.
Oh, there we go.